Hi, I'm Roy Sedegrodner. Welcome to my YouTube site. I've just spent 2 months locked up at the Princess Alexandra Hospital, and I was allowed leave from the hospital from time to time. And I've posted some stuff on YouTube during the leave that I had. And now I've been discharged from the hospital. This is about 2 months ago. But I'm forced to go back to the clinic, the outpatient clinic run by the hospital, every 2 weeks to be injected with a drug called risperidone consta. Now this drug slows me down a little bit and makes me a bit sleepy, from more so than I would be usually, and a bit stiff in my movements. And it's not very good for my love life, but I'm managing to cope with it better than when they injected me with Zugrub and Thixol when I was locked up in the hospital. After my last bit of footage that I shot and posted on YouTube, they locked me up in the AOA, the locked area within the locked area, for 11 days, which was absolutely horrible. And I thought I'd continue where I left off before I was locked up. Where I was talking about my peace plan for Sri Lanka. And I mentioned in there the demilitarization of medicine. And first of all, I should establish that medicine has been militarized in the first place. And I'm specifically talking about psychiatry and immunology, which are two areas that are in cancer research, in which I have done some research myself. Today I'm just going to start off with just talking about a little manual called The Nervous Soldier. And this manual is a handbook for the prevention, detection and treatment of nervous invalidity in war, published by the University of Queensland, where I got my medical degree in 1983. This was published in Brisbane in 1943. And the authors are John Bostock and Evan Jones. Now, Evan Jones was famous already at that time as the psychiatrist or the doctor who accompanied Mawson in his explorations of the Antarctica. John Bostock was a research professor of medical psychology at the University of Queensland and psychiatrist to the Department of Repatriation in Brisbane, which is a military hospital, and senior psychiatrist to the Brisbane General Hospital. Now, I did my residency at the Royal Brisbane Hospital, which was the old Brisbane General Hospital. And this was a booklet that was for the doctors in the front line to decide how to who to send back to base for treatment and who to try and get patched up from their nervous invalidity and sent back to the front line. And this was, of course, in the middle of the towards the end of the Second World War. And this book explains right at the beginning, when they talk about the psychology of the soldier, that all strong emotional conflicts lead to an anxiety state, and hence the commonest of nervous symptoms can always be accepted as indicating conflict. Now, what he explains early on is that this conflict, one of the sources of this conflict, is the fact that people have to be trained to follow orders to kill people. And this is against our instincts, which is to preserve life. And everything that we learn from infancy onwards, which is about to preserve life and look after people. So they explain that it is necessary to drink alcohol or give the people alcohol at times, the soldiers, so that they can cope with the stress of living in barracks and being deprived of their normal civilian life. The reason that I'm mentioning this Nervous Soldier book is that it shows the way that the psychiatry profession was integrated with the general medical profession. He was a senior psychiatrist at the Brisbane General Hospital and also a military psychiatrist. Now, when I was studying at the Royal Children's Hospital, when I worked as a registrar there, the head of the Department of Pediatrics, or the head of the Royal Children's Hospital, was Major General John Pern. Now, John Pern was the most senior doctor in the Australian Army. And he was also a professor of pediatrics and head of the pediatrics department. I understand that John Pern worked at the Brisbane Hospital, Royal Brisbane Hospital, during the Vietnam War. And it's unknown to most people, and was unknown to me, that the criteria for the diagnosis of schizophrenia, personality disorder, and mania, which were three reasons to be discharged from the army or from conscription, which was active at that time during the Vietnam War and the Korean War, that these criteria were used and developed by the American military to screen who should work, who should serve, as they called it, as soldiers. So obviously people who are pacifists and against war and people who don't follow orders very readily are not regarded as very good soldiers. And people like myself would be terrible soldiers because I don't believe in killing people, even if I'm ordered to do so. And I think that in that way I'm like most of the people on the planet. But when they're forced to kill people through conscription, which is what happened during the Korean War and the Vietnam War, these people were labeled as schizophrenic or manic. If they were outspoken about it, they were called manic. If they disobeyed orders, they would be called manic. If they were spontaneous, they would be said to be impulsive, and that would be mania. Of course, it's not the only reason that people got called manic. And in fact, there are people who are very, very elevated and high and talk at 100 miles an hour and go through periods of big mood swings as well. And these people will also get labeled as manic and having bipolar disorder or manic depression. But it also is such a broad criterion or broad criteria that are used that they can also be used for people who are outspoken against the system, for people who are pissing off their families or pissing off their workmates. And or their teachers at university, and the same criteria that I use for mania in terms of an elevated mood are also used at times for the diagnosis of schizophrenia. And also the incidence of schizophrenia and mania has increased in the cities where they're being diagnosed the most. And there is, you can check on the internet and see what the current incidence is of schizophrenia and mania. But the statistics themselves are compiled by the World Health Organization, which works hand in hand with the American Psychiatric Association. And the American Psychiatric Association works hand in hand with the American military. Of course, these are all just branches of the American government. So when they say that you're paranoid to believe that the CIA are spying on you, you have to understand that it's the people who are working hand in hand with the CIA and the FBI and the American security apparatus that are accusing people of being paranoid if they believe things that are denied by these organizations. Because these organizations are secretive, of course, it lends itself to paranoid ideas. But when I was in hospital over the 2 months, I came to the conclusion that a lot of the people in there are actually mad. But the hospital environment makes them more mad. There's a punitive mentality where the reward is to be discharged from the hospital. And you get grading of reward from half an hour escorted leave within the hospital to half an hour unescorted leave, or an hour to walk across to the shopping center across the road for an hour. All of these are based on this reward of being allowed to leave the ward. So they can't make the ward a nice place, because then it will not work to give people the reward of leaving it. So therefore they have taken all the therapy rooms that were designed and the architect's plan when it was first built. And this is only, you know, 10 years ago or so that this block was built. There were therapy rooms, and these have all been converted to rooms where the nurses have, and the team workers and the psychiatrists have meetings. And there's more and more administration and less time that anyone spends with talking to the people who are in there, most of whom want to leave, or many of whom want to leave. The ones who are in there become very quickly institutionalized and are standing there queuing up for their meals as they're served 3 times a day, and so was I, for that matter, because it's the most interesting thing that actually goes on all day. The therapy rooms are not equipped very well, even though there are art materials stocked up in cupboards, and there are some musical instruments that are locked away, and they don't employ a music therapist. The music therapist left and they haven't employed another one. They don't have an art therapist because they don't want to pay for an art therapist. Instead, they get a elderly nurse who knows a little bit of craft and beading and stuff to be running the programs, the health programs. And she doesn't want more pay or promotion to do the job properly, because it'll interfere with her pension. Her war pension, mind you. So this PA hospital, when I was first locked up there 10 years ago, or no, wouldn't have been as much as that, it was about, 2002, 2003, the security guards were still wearing military badges and insignia. And the threat system is, we'll call security. And security are Vietnam veterans. There are a number of Vietnam veterans and just basically thugs who are taught to put people in stress positions and hold them down with using stress positions until they are injected. And they ask no questions, and they're big intimidating guys who just grab you if you try and run away. They'll run after you and tackle you and bring you down, and then hold you down. And in 2003, when I was locked up 5 times back in 2000.